To sit in a tree and watch the coming of dawn is a strange thing. As soon as you can see the ground with any detail, it seems that you're twice as high as you thought you were. Tree stumps go through brief periods when they look like people. The root wads of overturned trees look like bears. You can't tell whether the trail you're sitting along passes through a large meadow you should have noticed earlier, or just a slight opening in the trees that you wouldn't have noticed earlier. But as the light comes up enough to make out the individual leaves on the ground, you realize that you're only as high as you thought you were. The stumps go back to being stumps, the root wads back to root wads. The trail begins to look like how you remembered it. But then after a while, the trail I was sitting above did not look at all how I remembered it. The buck was coming down it, moving with an almost cat-like sense of purpose. It was just like my father predicted, almost as if he had summoned the deer and sent it to me. In the instant that I registered the animal's presence, I also registered the idea that it would be beneath me within seconds. This realization was outside the experiences that I'd had while sitting in a tree stand with my dad or my brothers. Usually we'd see deer coming along the edge of a field far away or coming from way back in the woods. There'd be plenty of time to get accustomed to its presence. The initial adrenaline rush from seeing the animal would fade a little before you were hit by the second adrenaline rush of having the animal come close. But this deer was compressing that experience into a single moment, stacking the rushes into a precarious heap. The pores on my skin rushed open in a wave of heat, the way they do when you're in a sweat lodge at the moment they pour the cold water over the hot rocks. My knees weakened and my hands shook as I reached for my bow. The three middle fingers on my left hand were protected by a split leather tab, and I wrapped them around the bow's string, two fingers below the nocked arrow, one above it. At this point, I could see the deer's shoulder from a lateral perspective. The moment that the deer's head passed behind a tree, I'd pull back my bow and sink the arrow into the rear crease of the shoulder's muscle. At the time, there were two competing thoughts in my mind, one for each of the possible outcomes. The first was the thought of killing the buck. I imagine the purity of the pride that my father would feel. I imagine the glory of returning home with my first deer and then going to school and bragging about it. I imagined us ribbing groters about how even a 12-year-old could kill a deer cleanly with a bow if he knew what he was doing. The second was the thought of wounding the buck. I'd seen this happen a few times already, and it was awful. One night years earlier, my dad had hit a deer with his bow, and he took me and my brothers out after dark to track it. All we could find were little pin drops of blood on the yellowish maple leaves of the forest floor. Some of the drops were purplish from bile, which meant a gut-shot deer that would be tough to find even though it would almost surely die within a few days. By midnight, I was too tired and couldn't keep up, so my dad left Danny with me and told us to wait in the bottom of a ravine. He gave us one lantern and took Matt and the other lantern to push ahead. Our lantern ran out of gas, and we had to wait in the cold dark. Around 1 a.m., our dad came back, having lost the deer's trail up ahead. He looked sick with self-disgust. Author's note. That night, driving home at around 2 a.m., my dad hit a yearling deer that jumped out in front of the truck, a Jeep Grand Cherokee. He picked it up and threw it into the back. Moments later, Matt and Danny were yelling and screaming from the back seat that the deer was alive. It was actually standing up in the rear of the Jeep. My dad slammed on the brakes, hauled the deer back out of the Jeep, cut its throat, let it bleed out, and then he threw it back in. The remainder of the 8-mile drive was uneventful. As this deer rounded the tree, I was met with a third scenario that I could never have imagined. The strength in my arms had vanished, and I simply could not pull the bow back. I tugged and tugged, but the string wouldn't budge. The deer passed me by, never knowing I was there. Then when the opportunity for a shot had passed, the string pulled back in my hands as easily as if I were practicing. I pointed the arrow in the direction of the deer, without really thinking about where it would go, and let the arrow fly.